It's wonderful to see all of you here. I'm Joyce McConnell, the Dean at West Virginia University College of Law. I deeply appreciate you being here for the Archibald McDougall Lecture Series. Thank you for the office. Thank you to the Office of International Programs. I believe Michael Lastinger is here, its director, and the Latin American Studies Program. Is the director here of that program? I'm sorry, she's not here. And we really appreciate them joining with us in this cross-disciplinary effort to bring to you some of the newest thinking about the future of Mexico. I want to tell you a little bit, just for a moment, about our guests who are here from Mexico, for those of you who have not been to the previous lectures, and then I'm going to actually let the next speaker introduce all of the panelists. But I want to personally say how much I appreciate Professor Begné, Professor Patron, and Professor Rodriguez being with us from Guanajuato. The WVU College of Law has had a long-standing relationship with the law school, the University of Guanajuato, in part started by one of our former deans, Carl Selinger, and his dear wife is here, widow is here, who has known Professor Begné from, I think, the very beginning of the relationship. So this goes back many, many years, something that we're very proud of, and something that we're pleased to say actually has grown substantially. So thank you very, very much. I also want to thank our other panelists for being with us today, because you represent the best of an interdisciplinary effort to bring greater understanding to the future of a country that lies so close to us and shares so many interests with us. As a token of our appreciation for being our guests today, I have a few gifts that I want to give our panelists and a few gifts that I would like to give our visitors. I had to give different gifts because we've been exchanging many gifts to our panelists. Very important to share gifts across borders. More so, we're sharing material gifts as well as intellectual gifts, which is actually the best part of the celebration. I want to take a few minutes to tell you about the Archibald McDougall Lecture Series on International Law, because it's actually quite unusual. We have had this lecture series for more than a quarter century, a long time before anyone started really talking every day about a global world, about globalization. We have had a history here of being very committed to issues that are critical to the global community. And I want to say a thank you to Professor Selinger, who is no longer with us, and to Professor Friedberg, because they were actually many, many decades ahead of their time and served a lot of time in the trenches building the international programs here. The McDougall Lecture Series actually aided them in that effort. When Archibald McDougall bequeathed the funds that established the lecture series at the College of Law. And Archibald McDougall was really a very interesting man. He was a lawyer. He lived in Berkeley County in the eastern part of the state, and he embodied West Virginia's ties to the wider world. He was not a WVU graduate. He was born in 1908 in Hobart, Tasmania, and earned his bachelor's and law degrees from the University of Tasmania. He was a Rhodes Scholar. He was educated at Oxford and Columbia. And for most of his career, he was active in diplomatic affairs. He was a representative to the United States Senate Legislative Council's office, legal advisor to the Minister of Foreign Affairs, and a law professor in Iraq. He was a delegate to the League of Nations. He represented British interests in America during World War II, and after the war, he was a legal advisor at the British Embassy in Egypt and the British Foreign Affairs Office. In 1952, however, he moved to Berkeley County from Washington, D.C. He was a well-known attorney in the area, president of the Berkeley Bar Association, was a member of the West Virginia State Bar, the American Bar Association, and he was admitted to the United States Supreme Court and Great Britain's Middle Temple Bar. He passed away in 1984 before I had the opportunity to meet him, but his legacy lives on in this amazing lecture series on international law. And we are very, very proud to be able to have the Archibald McDougall Lecture Series to demonstrate our continuing commitment to international programs, particularly multidisciplinary programs that allow us to explore diverse points of views on issues critical to the global legal community. Thank you all very, very much for being here with us today.
Hi, I think I'm next. I'm Jim Friedberg. I'm the moderator for the panel. You've heard, if you've been here through the week, a lot of introductions already. And with six people, I'm going to make the introductions brief in both consideration to them and consideration to you, I hope. And I'm going to do them one at a time as they come up. Michelle Stevens is a new professor at WVU in the Department of History. When I started asking around as to whom I should ask to create a panel that was truly interdisciplinary and was centered on expertise in Mexico, at least two or three people throughout the university mentioned Michelle's name as a really smart, energetic Mexican scholar. That is, scholar about Mexico. She's actually a U.S. citizen, I think, but she's a scholar about Mexico. She's a PhD from the University of Oklahoma, and today she's going to be speaking to one of her areas of expertise, which is the role of indigenous people in recent Mexican history and perhaps also their struggles to adapt to the changes in present-day Mexico, which is making the transitions about which we have been speaking all week. Michelle.
Well, I'd like to thank the College of Law and thank you to Jim for that introduction. I'm not really good with microphones. I think partly it's because I'm short. It's also because I don't use them very often. I am from the great state of New Jersey, as many of you are as well. And in New Jersey, they teach us to pontificate and to project. So I'm going to try to not use the microphone, and we'll see how that goes. If I get too soft-spoken, just holler, and I will. I'll speak a little bit more loudly. What I want to do today is introduce you to an aspect of my research that builds out of my doctoral dissertation, and that is about a small indigenous group in western Mexico known as the Huichols, or in Spanish they would be pronounced the Huicholes. It's a bit of a misnomer to use this word to describe this group. I'm going to have to use the microphone because I'm going to walk around a little bit. As my students, the few of you that are here know, I tend to pace a little bit, so I know that the microphone might be somewhat problematic, but I'll try to stick to the lectern a little bit more forcefully. The name that they call themselves and the name that has been popping up in the media more frequently, including in the last couple of months, is the Huicharitari, and that's the name that they call themselves. But historically, they've gone by Huicholes. That's what the Spanish called them, among a bunch of other different names that have come up. If you go back to the very early 16th century sources that come up that the Spanish produced as they went about conquering western Mexico, which you see here. Do I have a little laser pointer? Uh-oh. There we go. I'm a little bit technologically unsavvy here sometimes, but at any rate, we're not going to point. There we go. Okay, we're not going to point. I'm just going to point. This is Western Mexico. We'll pretend that this is my laser pointer here because I don't have my little projector. But at any rate, this is a map of Western Mexico. You can see the Pacific Ocean there. Guadalajara is sort of to the sort of lower right-hand corner. And the Huichols are centered sort of in the middle of this image. Why are they important? Well, they're a rather small group, so that in and of themselves is somewhat unimportant. They're important because they're one of the few Mexican indigenous groups today that maintains a significant amount of their traditional, scare quotes, their traditional indigenous beliefs. They still speak their indigenous language that they've spoken for as long as anybody can remember. They have not been Christianized to any great degree. They still live in what they consider to be their traditional homelands. And they've done this with tremendous difficulty. They managed to fight off the Mexican state. And when I say fight, I mean literally fight with guns, but also using the court systems, using any tools that they had at their disposal. So because I realize that many of you may not have much of a background in Mexican history, I'm going to step back a little bit, talk about my research in Mexican history, and then I'll fast forward in the little bit of time that I have and talk about some of the problems that Mexican indigenous groups face today. And then I'll give you, if I have a minute, a brief sketch as to why it is that I came about this topic. Western Mexico came under Spanish conquest in the 1530s and 40s, but the Huichols themselves aren't conquered until the 1720s. Now, why is that? It's because this area that you see on the map is really mountainous. There's no great empires there. So when the Spanish experienced any kind of resistance, they tended to just sort of draw back a little bit, and the native peoples living in the areas simply fled into the mountains, which they considered to be what Mexican anthropologists in the 1940s termed regions of refuge. So the Huichols, being somewhat reticent to deal with the Spanish, simply fled into the mountains. Following on the heels of Spanish conquerors, Christian missionaries, mostly Franciscans and Jesuits, moved into the area and attempted to Christianize these different indigenous groups. There are myriad, the Huichols being one of probably 50 or 60. They're very unsuccessful in conquering or Christianizing the Huichols, and there's a couple of different reasons for this. The Huichols themselves have a very intricate symbolic religious complex that ties their religious beliefs to their land. So if they give up their land, they give up their religious practices and vice versa. And I'm going to skip ahead, and I'm not going to use this little gadget because I don't know what I'm doing with it. Their religion is centered around the use and consumption of peyote, and I bring this up partly to talk about why they're so resistant to change, but also to talk about some of the things that I want to mention when we get to the modern period. So the Huichols, living in the modern states of Jalisco, Nayarit, and Zacatecas and Durango to a lesser extent, are in western Mexico. Peyote grows in northeastern Mexico. Okay, so remember that for when I get to the end of my talk in a few minutes. This symbolic complex is also tied very closely to something that you might be able to see to the right of the peyote button here, which that figure is prominently in the center, and that's the deer. Okay, so the deer is the second part of this symbolic trio. The third is corn. So you've got this symbolic trinity, the symbolic trio, that makes up the components of Huichol religion. Okay? That is tied intricately to their land, which is located in western Mexico. When Christians came in, of course, as you might imagine, they tried to change this religious belief. And the Huichols would not give this up. Combined with that, they won't give up their land. Okay? Over the course of 200 years, the Spanish were gradually able to move into the area, gradually conquer the indigenous peoples. That included the Huichols. We fast forward to 1810. As Mexico coalesces and moves towards its independence fight, the Huichols have no dog in the race, as they say. And we don't know a whole lot about what happens in the mountains in this area. So when I'm writing my dissertation, what was really complicated about the whole process was I have these decades, in fact, when I can't write the story of Ruby Tolles. And so I have to kind of zoom in and zoom out during different periods of time. And that's one of the hardest things about understanding indigenous history, particularly in western Mexico. In other parts of Mexico, for instance, in Yucatan or in southwestern Mexico, it's a lot easier to write about Mexican indigenous populations over really long, expansive periods of time because you have lots of sources. In western Mexico, that's often not the case. And so one of the challenges writing about Native populations from a historical perspective is a lack of sources, and that's precisely the problem I have in the independence period. But one of the neat things about western Mexico is that, particularly in the 1850s, you get a convergence of events related to things going on in Mexico City, namely a period of time called the Reform Wars. And the Reform Wars are related to different political events, which if I had, as my students in the room could tell you, if I had 3 weeks, we could talk about them at length. But I don't have 3 weeks, so in 2 minutes, I'll tell you. The Reform Wars revolve around liberal and conservative politics, and all of this relates to Mexico becoming an increasingly globalizing country, and how land factors in and how indigenous people factor in is in the commodification of land. And as land becomes a valuable commodity, indigenous peoples begin to lose out. Because indigenous peoples believed in and practiced communal landholding practices, essentially. Right? So what happens in the 1850s in western Mexico that makes the Huicholes more easy to track and more easy to write about is a rebellion known as the Losada Rebellion. And the Losada Rebellion occurs between 1857 and 1874 and is exceptionally well documented, and we're able to see Huichol participation in defense of their lands. And it's an armed defense of their lands. This ends in the 1870s with the rise of Mexico's most famous dictator, Porfirio Díaz, who in 1876 took over Mexico in a 36-year-long reign, which ended with the Mexican Revolution in 1911. And that's where my story stops. Why does my story stop in 1911? Because with the advent of the Mexican Revolution, again, the Huicholes fall out of the picture. And it becomes increasingly difficult to write about an indigenous group when you don't have people writing, okay, well, this indigenous group, we think they're the Huicholes, did this on this day. When people are killing each other for political reasons, they're often not recording the indigenous names of the people who are doing the killing. Okay, so how does my research relate to what's going on in Mexico today? One of the biggest problems that indigenous groups face, particularly in western Mexico, is the advent of both NAFTA, but also the drug trade. Okay. When NAFTA became essentially the economic practice of Mexico and the United States, it created significant unemployment in indigenous villages. It created it's a very complicated way to describe, but essentially there's no need, or there's no farming available in indigenous villages, particularly in western Mexico. Okay, so males essentially leave the country, and this creates a significant drive to the U.S. border. So what you have left in indigenous villages, particularly in western Mexico, are the women. And women in indigenous villages don't farm. So you have a fragmentation of native communities. This also begins to change what it means to be indigenous, particularly in Huichol communities, whereby in 1890, if you left your community, you were no longer indigenous. So one of the problems that economic downturn has created is a rethinking of what it means to be native. The other thing that I mentioned is the advent of the narco trade. One of the ways that indigenous communities have found the easy way to make money is to grow marijuana. Okay, it's a quick buck. They live in rural areas. If your family is starving, oftentimes it's your only option. And then finally, and I think I'll stop at this because I think I've gone over my 10 minutes because I pontificate. I read an article very recently about the peyote hunt. This is something that the Huichols have been doing for at least 150 years that we can look into the archives and see. And it's been an increasing problem that when the Huichols go on their peyote hunt, they're being arrested. And this has never happened before. And so as Mexico globalizes, we find a number of problems that Native peoples face, okay? Not the least of which is profound unemployment, which leads to immigration, which fractures communities. And then the drug trade has a number of devastating impacts. Do we grow marijuana so that we can make money for our families? And conversely, it also impacts ancient traditions that, have traditional implications. And indigenous communities have been struggling for years, essentially, dealing with the implications of that. And I'll stop there because, I don't have 50 minutes to talk about this. Thank you. I forget that I'm not in the classroom. Sorry about that.
No problem.
All right, let me get out of here.
Thank you, Michelle. If you noticed me wandering around, it was to try to solve the mystery of the non-working laser pointer. And I've been informed that the laser pointer doesn't work on a really bright screen, diminishing its utility somewhat.
Okay. And it can always be me with my technology.
So if you had wanted to point to something on one of those walls, it would have worked perfectly well. The next speaker is an engineer, and I want us all to, by the end of this panel, hopefully be somewhat convinced that this is not an exercise in disjointedness, but an exercise in complexity. Mexico is a complex story. Much is going on, and many people at WVU are doing research and fieldwork in Mexico that relate to many different problems, and those problems all somehow, I think, are part of a bigger quilt, if I can use an Appalachian metaphor. So with that, I'd like to introduce Victor Mucino, our own Victor Mucino, though he's also a son of Mexico as well as a mountaineer. He's been in West Virginia, I won't say how many years. He graduated with a PhD from the University of Wisconsin. For many years, he's been taking WVU students on practical work to central Mexico, particularly to the beautiful city of Querétaro, and doing industrial projects with those engineering students in cooperation with Mexican enterprise. And he's going to tell us about that.
Thank you, Jim, and I'd like to thank the College of Law for the opportunity to share some of my experience in the last 20 years of working with people in Mexico. As you can tell, I am originally from Mexico, and I had the opportunity to be educated both in Mexico and in the United States. I also worked in industry as a professional both in Mexico and also in the United States. And I have been in academia, both in Mexico and the United States. And for the last 20 years, we have had very strong relationships with several universities in Mexico. And that has allowed me to put together some kind of an experiment in which we try to bring together four different cultures. There is a culture of academia. the culture of industry, which are two different cultures, the culture, of course, of Mexico and the culture of the United States. And we try to do this in a way in which we try to develop ourselves as professionals, not only in Mexico, but also in the U.S. We have to decide whether we are educators or practitioners. That's a difficult choice for me. Sometimes I feel like I'm a practitioner when I am in industry, and many times then I go to the role of educator. And I think that that's a wonderful opportunity to be a little bit in both worlds. But when we take students to Mexico, we make them work in intermixed teams. We take students from Mexico, students from West Virginia. They form intermixed teams, and then we place them to do professional work with companies, companies like General Electric, Bombardier, Case New Holland, etc. And basically, we just create an environment in which students, faculty members, and practitioners come together to work in specific projects. And that's pretty standard. That's pretty simple. But I think that what brings richness and lifelong learning is has to do with the cultures, not only the academic culture and the industrial culture, but, of course, the Mexican and American cultures that come forward. When these groups are working under pressure, because working in a professional environment means working many times under pressure, because we have to deliver results, because we have to deliver that timely, and because we have to work within budget, and all those pressures that people live in the real life out in industry, those pressures provide us an enormous opportunity for faculty members to get a sense of reality. We are educating students, but we have to get an idea of what we are preparing the students to confront when they finish. But this pressure of these students working on their, in this environment brings forward the personalities, the cultures, idiosyncrasies. And sometimes because of that situation, I have the opportunity to witness some of the contrasts between, you know, in all the cultures. I should say that, for example, academia, we have a culture. I think that Pierre Bourdieu, I believe, indicated that academia is second to church as one of the most traditionalist and conservative institutions in history. And I think that, you know, there's a point to that. I think in academia we have our traditions, we have our standards of excellence, we have our measures of success. I think we all know what the measures of success are in our respective fields. Industry is quite different. Industry, they have a totally different approach. They are not traditionalists. They are evolving. They are always in the fast move. They adapt, okay? And their measures of success are drastically different. So here we are trying to produce graduates that can function in an environment that is totally different to ours. So I think that this kind of connection is bringing a lifelong learning for all of those involved. The other thing that this opportunity provides is to witness how the cultures actually have to do with the professional work. Now, if I talk about thermodynamics, I can assure you that thermodynamics is the same in China, in Mexico, in the U.S., you name it. Everywhere is the same thing. So technology is the same everywhere else. What changes is the people that's behind it. And when you have different cultures, then problems are addressed in different perspectives. And that produces sometimes this pressure. It turns out that today, in the world that we live, success means being able to get across cultures, particularly in the area of technology and science. Being successful or bringing success means being able to get across multiple cultures because science does not have borders, and same thing with technology. And when we see a situation of stress, we can see some of the difference. I'll just give you a couple of observations, for example. When I have a group of students that are under pressure because they have to deliver results by Monday morning, and it's Friday, and the pressure is on, then our students, not all of them, but some of them, they project self-assuredness. They're self-assured. But that projection of self-assuredness becomes aggressiveness under pressure. And, of course, when that happens, I realize that, or I try to be attentive to those situations so I can mediate, so I can, you know, bring some sense, and typically I do. And but there's the other side. And the other side is students who intend to be so respectful of others that out of respect, they keep their ideas to themselves. They don't speak. Or they kind of retract themselves and out of respect become timid or shy. And those are the signs of a culture combined with a pressure in a professional environment. And that's, I believe, what gives us the best opportunities to act and point out. They say, look, you have to be respectful, but that doesn't mean you stay quiet. I mean, you speak up your mind. Say what you have to say respectfully. And on the other hand, you can be self-assured and project this, assurance, but that doesn't mean you have to be aggressive. And that you can notice that in some subtle ways. For example, the volume of the voice. You know, if I am right, I speak louder, and that makes me more correct. Well, little things like that. In terms of professionals, both in Mexico and the U.S., there are also significant differences. I think that in academia in Mexico, there is this tendency in academia in Mexico of having two divisions. The undergraduate division, that's what they call them, division. Undergraduate division and graduate division. And that is nothing but a basic division. What that produces, it produces a class or two classes in itself. And professors in the graduate division are typically, higher degrees. It brings higher status. And they don't deal with the undergraduate programs, whereas the undergraduate programs are far away from the graduate programs. So that's something that I don't particularly like. I lived through that, and I remembered not being exposed to the research activity when I was undergraduate, and when I was in the graduate division as a faculty member, that was more of a club. So that's a significant difference. In the U.S., we have both graduate and undergraduate programs handled in the same unit. So there's a little bit, a different approach. But that has an impact in the profession. There are many students who graduate in Mexico that come from very large schools. The school that I went to has about 250,000 students. UNAM, the school that I was teaching, has about 350,000 students. So it's massive, okay? So what's going to happen is that the spread of skill and preparedness is very broad. So we have many graduates who have deficiencies, who have a degree and are out in industry. Unfortunately, deficiencies, if any student brings a deficiency to graduation, most likely the deficiency becomes a life deficiency for life. And it's interesting to see that when I go to Mexico and I talk to some of the engineers, how they compensate for deficiencies. They are creative. They bring some artistic elements to it. They bring personality, but as opposed to skill. In what I see more in the U.S., people are not depending so much in their creativeness. They depend more on the skill that they develop. And there are some important impacts of that, because I think that what changes is the expectation in life. I think that if you ask, and of course, these are just my personal opinions and observations, okay? So I may be completely wrong. But if you ask an average student what they expect to achieve in life and how they are going to attain success, I think that, yes, success means hard work, but it also means having the right friends, and it also means a little bit of luck. Okay. And if I have the combination of if I work hard and if I am loyal to my friends, if I and if I have a little bit of luck, I'm going to be successful. I think that in America we have a slightly different way of looking at success. I think that success means you really have to know what you're doing, work hard, and luck means opportunity and being prepared. So we have different takes on this. But that makes our sort of personal relationships change a little bit. Now, why am I doing this? We have more than 2,000 miles of border. Mexico is really, really close. We have, and Mexico is a land of contrasts. We have many rural areas with extreme social issues to address, but we have areas of outstanding beauty and outstanding potential. The area that I'm going to, Querétaro, is spectacular in what's going on. And not only Querétaro, that region, Guanajuato, Querétaro, all El Bajío that is known, is going through a spectacular spurt of technological and economic growth. I think that the opportunities are plenty for many professions and universities in the U.S., and I think that we are leading in that effort. So with that, I'd like to close, and I thank you for your attention.
It's interesting that in such disparate fields as historical studies about indigenous people and practical applied learning and engineering, the thread of Mexico's meeting or at least grappling with the challenge of modernity is common. And I think it will be seen to be common in the talk of the third speaker as well, another new WVU scholar. But before I introduce him, I'd like to mention that in our audience, we have somebody that's probably responsible in some part for there being such a wonderful breadth of exploration, academic and practical knowledge at WVU. When something happens today, that means that somebody planned it in some ways years ago. And David Hardesty is probably one of the people that is somewhat responsible for a panel like this being able to be put together today. So thank you, David. Our next speaker makes me feel very secure standing here because he has a Bronze Star. Having spent some time doing graduate studies of a kind in Iraq. Arthur Reiser is a recent graduate from Georgetown University with an LLM and from Gonzaga with a JD, as well as being a veteran having served us in the Iraqi theater in Fallujah. He worked for the Justice Department immediately before coming to the law school and in their criminal division became somewhat of an expert in Mexico, maybe the less happy side of Mexico, but one that creates another common thread that is in the complex fabric that makes up that country. And I will ask Arthur to come to the stage and talk about his experiences in drug enforcement.
Okay, I think a couple, I always like to put things in perspective every time I speak to a group, and First, I am not from Mexico. And my perspective as a, talking here today is as a prosecutor who worked on, worked for the Special Operations Division, which is the unit within the Department of Justice with the sole purpose of targeting the command and control elements of the Mexican cartel, the Colombian cartel, and working with the government, the GOM, the government of Mexico, in order to bring these individuals to justice or sometimes kill them. And that is what I did for the last part of my career before I came to the law school. I worked on, you know, some big cases, including the indictment of Chapo Guzman. And as soon as he is caught, hopefully he'll be in court. I absolutely mean no disrespect or to sound ethnocentric with anything that I say. This is just a perspective from a prosecutor, an American prosecutor, which is important to keep in mind. I only have 10 minutes, so I'm going to paint this picture with a very thick brush. I want to talk about three areas, the history of this conflict, the ground truth. Why should we care as Americans? Is this just a Mexico problem, or is it a American continent problem, continents? And then some successes in Mexico and the ramifications of those successes. So what's happening in Mexico? And I think it's really important, and I'm glad we have a historian here, because the thrust of the war on drugs in Mexico, the Mexican drug war, started in Colombia. And in the 60s and the 70s, the appetite for cocaine in the United States was insatiable. And we wanted more of it. And they shipped us more of it. And they shipped it through Mexico. And the Mexicans have been experts for generations at getting things inside the United States. During Prohibition, they were excellent at getting booze inside the United States. They're very good at it. And they were the people who helped the Colombian cartels get drugs in the United States. Now, after a while, they got smart. And instead of taking cash payments, they said, wait a minute, we want half of the shipment. They took payment in kind. And gradually, they turned into what I would refer to as gangs and into cartels in their own rights. Yesterday, we learned a little bit about the government in Mexico and how it's structured. And we learned that for 75 years, you know, our esteemed professor here said that one party kind of operated and controlled Mexico. And this is really important because that party operates much like political parties operate in the United States, like, you know, the Byzantine bureaucracies, where the political bosses really contained all the power. And so the cartels learned if they were able to bribe the political chiefs, more importantly, the police, they gained enormous amount of control over the ground. And so the local police became more responsible of maintaining political order, and less concerned with in solving and investigating crimes. And in this landscape, the cartels boomed, and they exploded, and the appetite for drugs in the United States exploded, and more drugs came to the United States from Mexico. So who are we talking about? I'm going to very briefly go over the cartels. Who are the players? Now, this is a very complex issue, and this is literally a very brief overview. But let's talk about the big dogs. All right, so we have the Sinaloa cartel and we have the Zetas. And underneath those cartels, they have, almost vassals. For instance, under the Zetas, the Juarez cartel used to be kind of against them, and then the Zetas killed a lot of their leadership, and they became a vassal of the Zetas. The Sinaloa cartel are, still the big dogs on the block. They are incredibly sophisticated. They run their operation like a business. Chapo Guzman is, if anybody knows where he is, there you go. The Gulf cartel used to be the big rival to the Sinaloa cartel, but they made a big mistake. They hired these guys called the Zetas, and they hired them. The Zetas were what we would consider Green Berets in the United States. They were actually trained in the United States, but nobody wants to talk about that. And these individuals were trained by U.S. Special Forces. They went to Mexico. They worked for the Gulf cartel. And then sooner or later, they said, why am I taking orders from you? And they just killed off the Gulf cartel, and they took over most of their territory. Gulf cartel is still around. The Zetas we just talked about, what a lot of people would consider the most violent and ruthless. When you hear about heads, you know, found on the road, it's usually the Zetas that are involved. La Familia, this cartel has been really diminished. I have them in there because I'm very interested in this cartel because they actually have political motives. They actually have a political agenda. They actually have, like, a Bible that says, you know, we want to make meth, send it to the United States to kill gringos. It's in their literature, which the reason I study them a lot is because that technically, I think, makes them a terrorist organization because they use violence in order to perpetuate a political agenda. The Templars took over a lot of La Familia. La Familia split. Some went one direction. A lot of them went with the Templars. The cartels are really sophisticated. They're not a bunch of thugs. These are very smart individuals. This is a badge that the Gulf cartel would issue their enforcers, and they walked around proudly with these on their chest. They have incredible amounts of money. Incredible amounts of money. This is not even the biggest seizure that we have made. They have religious ideology about who they are. And, you know, some developing concerns that we're going to talk about in a second. So after 100 years of the war on drugs in the United States, we have done nothing to make a dent in the amount of drugs in the United States. $65 billion a year is spent on illicit drug use in the United States. Estimated 25 million users. The Mexican cartels facilitate 90% of all the drugs in the United States. It might not come directly from Mexico, but it goes through their hands or they're in it in a way. The math is, you know, debatable, but a lot of people believe that the cartels profit collectively about $24 billion a year. Now, put this in perspective. Apple made $25 billion last year. Coca-Cola made $8. Walmart made $16. To understand what happened to the war on drugs, and I only have about 5 minutes left, but you got to look at 2000. You know, President Fox started this. And then 2006, President Calderon really bumped it to the next level. He took 50,000 federal troops and police, and he really went after the cartels in a military tactics. And they had a lot of success. 60,000 individuals were arrested. They sent many of their high-level traffickers to the United States. But that war has had costs. Now, people debate about how many deaths have occurred in Mexico over this war. But, I mean, the official number from the government of Mexico is about 85,000. A lot of people believe it's a lot more than that. If you take the Iraq War and the Afghanistan War and combine them, more people have died since 2006 in Mexico related to the war on drugs. And a lot of people think, well, you know, the cartels are killing themselves. That's not really the case. There is a lot of violence. A lot of the deaths are related, but a lot of the deaths are also, you know, innocent bystanders. I mean, there was a case where there was a hit on a member of the cartel at a car wash. They went in, they killed him, the Zetas, and then they killed 19 other people that happened to be there that day. This is a real concern, which leads me to my next point, is why should we care? You know, we've been at war for over 10 years with Islamic fundamentalists, but my opinion, this really should be the pointy end of our spear. If you look at the 2009 Joint Forces Command published, this is the command in the United States that looks at national security threats, and they said the two countries that are at most risk for failed state status was Pakistan and Mexico. One has nuclear weapons, and the other one shares a 2,000-mile border with the United States. In a minute, I'll tell you that I think this is an exaggeration and fear-mongering, but it's still the amount of violence at our border affects our national security, and it affects, obviously, Mexico's national security. The potential for humanitarian crisis is staggering in Mexico. There are many people, if there is something is seen as not being able, take it back. If the people of Mexico start to feel like the government can't protect them, we could see a rush of refugees A lot of people thought this was going to happen a couple years ago, and it hasn't, and that's good news. And it's good news, I think it's not happening because the government has been successful in many ways. Our economy is very closely linked to Mexico. They're the 12th biggest economy in the world, and they are our third biggest trading partner. Also, which will lead me to my third point, this crisis really has the potential of spreading. Now, it's not going to spread north. You're not going to see, a lot of people talk about the drug war is going to spill into the streets of the United States. That's a possibility. I think it's an unlikely possibility, not because we have a great, you know, giant titanium wall up, but because the cartels do not want it to spill over because it's bad for business. But where does it spill over? And I think I want to direct you guys down to Guatemala. All those things we just talked about, all the problems that you see in Mexico are really highlighted in Central America. So as I mentioned earlier, the government of Mexico has had a lot of success at taking out high leadership. Last summer they arrested Zeta 40, Miguel Morales, who was the leader of the Zetas. And this has been a good consequence, but again, the cartels are moving south. And the countries that are south don't have the type of resources that Mexico does. And again, I do not think that you're going to have a failed state status in Mexico. Mexico has enormous and very powerful institutions. They've been around, the government's been stable for 90 years. They have a credible, powerful, well-trained military that's disciplined. They have a business community that is strong. But you can't say the same things for a lot of countries in Central America. Guatemala has declared officially that 50% of their nation is actively patrolled by the Zetas. Honduras has more people employed by the cartels than employed by the police and the military combined. And this is coming from their governments. So I don't have much time left, but I think as Americans, we should care about this because Mexico is our brother country, our sister country. They're right next door. We have enormous investments culturally and economically in that country. And I think that the lasting impression is that this is something that we should be doing, that we should take seriously as a national security threat. And we should be helping in order to help alleviate this problem in Mexico. And make Mexico safer and us safer at the same time. Thank you.
Okay. This is a bit of an experiment. Nobody on this panel purports to have expertise in the things that other people on the panel are talking about. But there is one thing in common. Everybody in the panel is a professor that has expertise in Mexico and cares about Mexico. With that as our common bond, I have asked our three Mexican professors Begné, Patron, and Rodriguez, who I won't fully introduce again because I've been introducing them this week, all week, and they're pretty bored with that. I will just say they're my three friends, Patricia Begné, Fernando Patron, and Katia Rodriguez. I've asked them to comment on and ask questions of our WVU experts to the extent that something strikes them of interest. And then I will ask the WV folks to comment on each other, and then I will ask you in the audience to ask your questions if we can. So with that, which of our Mexican guests would like to say something first? Katia.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for the presentations. I think all were very interesting. I would like to comment, ask some questions about the three presentations. In the case of the first presentation about Huichol community, I would like to ask you, Professor Stephens, In what extent do you think that the current situation of the Huichol community is due to its cultural tradition of not or staying in land in order to keep the culture alive? Or until what extent it is related with the poverty situation, I mean, the material conditions, their lack of opportunities? Do you think that if they had other kind of opportunities out of that territory, it would be possible for them to go to get other kind of jobs? I don't know. I think that your opinion in that would be very interesting.
That's a great question, and one of the things that I would have liked to talk about had I had a little bit more time is one of the things you see nowadays, and one of the ways that indigenous identity has changed among the Huichols is now we start to see more migration out to some of the cities. So particularly in Guadalajara, it's really common to see Huichol families. So whereas 50 or 60 years ago, or even 100 years ago, if you left your community, you severed your indigenous ties, nowadays you're seeing the recreation of communities in cities so that people don't have to sever their ties to their lands. So you'll have the nuclear community in San Andres or wherever up in the mountains, and then you'll have the recreation of a smaller sort of a satellite community in Guadalajara or Mexico City or Tepic and Nayarit or where have you. And you're even starting to see satellite communities in Los Angeles and Phoenix, where you have small sort of Huichol enclaves which allow the people to maintain their indigenous identities. They can maintain their languages, their artistic traditions, to some extent their religious traditions, of course, minus the peyote tradition, because, of course, if they're not part of the Native American Church in the United States, you can't consume peyote. But the economic realities of the late 20th and 21st century has required the Huichols to adapt in a way that I think is not unique. I don't want to say it's unique because you see this among the Zapotecs, the Mixtecs from southern Mexico. But what I think this globalizing world and globalizing Mexico in particular has forced many indigenous peoples to do is think about ways to recreate their communities in such a way that they maintain these quote-unquote traditions in large cities or in smaller towns outside of their traditional homelands. And the Huichols have been really, really good at doing that, despite the fact that 100 years ago, if you looked at them 100 years ago, you would say, okay, there's no way that they're going to be able to do this because they're so reticent to leave their towns. I think nowadays they've been pretty remarkable at their flexibility and their adaptability in certain circumstances.
Thank you. Should I continue asking questions?
Keep going.
Or?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah? Okay. Professor Mucino tells us about the relationship between culture and professional work, right? And while he was talking about difference in the way in which education happens in the United States and in Mexico, what suggestions do you have in order to improve education in Mexico, in addition to what I already mentioned, of relate undergraduate programs with research? But what else, any comments on what else do you think is possible to do?
Yes, thank you very much for the opportunity to expand on this point. I'll just make a very quick remark on this topic. I think that education as a whole is a big and important issue for any country. I think that that's a link that can bring cooperation between different countries, certainly between the U.S. and Mexico. If there is one area where we can cooperate is in education, and that's for the benefit of everybody. I think that one of the issues that I believe merits attention in Mexico is the fact that many of the undergraduate programs have been neglected in order to pursue graduate programs of excellence. And that has the impact of that is like a very kind of a strong distinction between the graduate and highly skilled people that can do research and the other professionals that are in industry who are far away from the research. And there's a big difference between them. So one of the points that I continue to bring to my colleagues when I have the opportunity in Mexico is that if we want to have in Mexico good quality graduate programs, we need to focus on the undergraduate programs. Unfortunately, in Mexico, it's a complicated situation, but the undergraduate programs are addressed by the Secretariat of Education, whereas the graduate programs are taken care of by the CONACYT. Mm-hmm. So if you want to do something that is intended to have an impact in graduate programs, but it addresses the undergraduate programs, and you don't have anybody to talk to. I mean, it's very complicated to bridge that. But I think that's one area that needs attention rather than focusing on many graduate programs of excellence that don't really meet the standards of excellence. I think we should focus on the model of programs of excellence at the undergraduate level. One example that I give my colleagues in Mexico is what happens at Ross Holman Institute of Technology. I don't know if you are familiar with that. But if you check on the Princeton Review, what school produces the best engineers in the U.S.? That's Ross Holman Institute of Technology. And that's a small little school in Indiana. But the issue is that that's the only thing they do. They don't grant graduate degrees. So I discussed that with my friends. I said, why don't we have schools that focus on getting the best engineer, undergraduate engineer? And if we do that, then graduate programs will just flourish.
Well, for Professor Reiser, very, very interesting presentation about the situation of cartels in Mexico. The problem, I mean, which is a huge problem in Mexico and in the United States. What is possible to do differently in terms of changing this, because as you mentioned, although there have been some improvement in the situation, and the government have capped some of the leaders of the cartels, but the problem is still there, and in my opinion, is even bigger now than in 2006. What do you think is possible to do different in order to change that situation?
There's no bullet that's going to solve the problem, but I mean, with any, I think you should address it like any economic problem where supply and demand, if there's demand, there's going to be supply. And, you know, one thing that we can do tomorrow, just put things in perspective, 40 to 60% of the profit margin for the cartels comes from pot, marijuana. And, you know, I've done hundreds of drug cases and dozens of cartel cases. They don't care about their drugs at all. I mean, they don't want their drugs to get seized, but they don't care. You know what they care about? Their money. They care a lot about their money. And a way to really stab at the heart of the cartels is to go after the profit margin. And so, you know, one thing that we can do tomorrow, and this is just the evidence is in the pudding. You know, in Washington and Colorado, when they were passing, you know, their laws to legalize marijuana, they were, you know, these kind of secret organizations lobbying against it, giving money to churches. In fact, the Mormon Church received money in order to, fight against this, and they gave the money back because they didn't know where it came from and no suspicion that it actually came from, cartels, because they don't want legalization of marijuana in the United States because they make money from it. So something we can do tomorrow would be to legalize marijuana, grow it, sell it, tax it, and have, you know, really cut down on the demand from, and this is coming from a prosecutor, I care about effect more than I did anything else. And then, you know, there's a whole series of things, but I think that's something we can do like that, that would really drastically change. I think that we have to identify the taboos in our culture, the American culture. We fuel this. I mean, to act like this is a Mexico problem is really not only insensitive, it's just wrong. This is a problem for the continent. And let's be honest, we are probably the biggest jerks in the problem. We pay for all this. 90% of all the drugs in the United States comes from Mexico. Well, guess where 90% of all the guns in Mexico comes from? What are they killing each other with? Somebody guess. United States. The United States of America. We give them the guns and we buy the drugs, and then we act like, oh, that third world country, how dare they? We are responsible. And so this has to be a solution that we work out together.
Thank you.
I think Professor Reiser has started his campaign for Professor of the Year. Patricia?
Okay. More than questions, I have comments because, as I said previously, I came here to learn, and believe me, I have learned so much, a lot. So regarding the Michelle's presentation, according to the official census in Mexico, there are more than 15 million indigenous people in the whole country. So we have to pay attention to these ethnic groups that for a long time it seems to me that they are invisible, do not pay attention to these people until some big event happens. So for Michelle, I have to say congratulations on your work, on your research, and it was very informative. So related to Professor Victor Mucino, I knew about his work since a long time ago, and I am very pleased to know that he is continuing doing this for the benefit of these both universities and for the benefit of the two communities involved. Regarding Professor Reiser, it was very informative the talk, because I didn't know how, well, I know what important and how big is this problem. But as I said, and Katia did the question that I have for him, and also, as I said in my presentation, the problem is for both countries, not only for Mexican, because we are involved in the same issue, and we have to work together. But again, I want to ask about the personal opinion of the Professor Reiser about what is he looking forward to the near future in Mexico. What does he thinks about this? What can we do in order, you just say that, but I want to ask the same, almost, about your personal point of view about this.
I think that, you know, in the very near future, mm-hmm. what can Mexico mm-hmm. do? Right. I think that they should keep the fight going. I think that they're doing an excellent job. I know a lot of people have, you know, the attitude is to surrender or to compromise with the cartels. And I, you know, what really frustrates me is when I hear Americans talking about how they need to compromise, and, you know, that would be like a Canadian during, you know, the rise of the mafia to be like, you know, why don't you guys just kind of work out your differences and let them go ahead and extort, you know, people and do all these terrible, evil things. The compromise is why Mexico got into the problem in the first place with, of course, us fueling the problem with guns and cash. Because for years and years and years, there was a truce. And then the truce ended, and it was bloody and violent. I think that even the new president has kept up the heat in order to target the command and control elements. But that has to go along with an effort to reduce the demand, and that has to happen in the United States.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Professor Patron, it's your turn, and especially I'm interested in your comment on the last comment, because I've heard you in the past be one of the advocates of a new truce with the drug cartels.
Yes, that's right. Well, I'm going to come in then to me in a few minutes. Thank you very much. Well, these three fascinating presentations. It was for me like watching a historical film, then an educational film, and last but not least, a horror film. No, I'm just kidding. No. It was very, very good, actually. I do have also some comments. I think that the questions that I was also going to ask our colleagues, some of them have already been addressed, and you have already answered them. One question, to Michelle before I comment on some of the things that she actually showed and told us during her presentation. Probably you have already said this, and I miss it.
But sure.
Why did you pick the rituals?
Oh, and I didn't, because I...
Oh, right.
No, I ran out of time, and I had hoped to. It was a complete accident. This project was built out of a seminar paper when I was a U.S. historian. Before I became a Latin Americanist, I was a U.S. historian studying Native North America, and I was in seminar with the professor who became my dissertation advisor, and I was struggling with the topic, and he threatened that I was not allowed to work on the Aztecs in any way, shape, or form. And so he said, there's this group out there in western Mexico. They've got a book of documents in the library. They're called the Huichols. I know they eat peyote. That's all I know.
Okay.
So go get this book. And so I got it, and I thought, okay, this is pretty interesting. And there's not been an English language history written of them yet. When I submit my manuscript in December, it will hopefully get a book contract and then be the first English language history of them.
Yes.
So it was a pure accident.
Serious research most of the times happens.
Yeah,
accident.
It's a pure accident. So
absolutely.
That's it. It was an accident of a graduate
that's
seminar.
Right. Yeah. No, yeah. I'm also very pro peyote as well.
Yeah.
Also, yeah, that's.
Yeah,
that's
and it has
thing.
You know it has no, peyote. But, so no, I've no, not no, tried no, it, but.
Yes, I want to comment on something that I think it's very relevant of your presentation, the role of globalization,
mm-hmm.
actually, reshaping all the culture of these groups, of
mm-hmm.
these indigenous groups, their life also, most of their ancestral traditions as well.
Mm-hmm.
Let me tell you that, of course, the Huicholes are not a unique case,
right.
Also in the country. I mean, you can actually see it. You mentioned in one of your responses, for instance, if I remember correctly, the Zapotecos
mm-hmm.
as well,
mm-hmm.
The Mayas, for
Mayas.
Instance. The Mayas, they are actually a larger group
sure.
than the Huicholes.
Much larger.
And globalization has had a very special effect, banning most of this ancestral culture as well.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that you are right in the sense that it's not voluntarily to give up all the traditions,
right.
all the culture, all the habits, and all the rituals as well. It's by need,
right.
most of the times.
Right.
And in order, of course, to to try to insert themselves, or not voluntarily, I need again
mm-hmm.
because they need it. Otherwise, they would disappear and that's it.
Sure.
They will starve to death, as you say it. In a country that is actually merged in the concept of globalization,
sure.
as it is. I don't know your opinion on this is something that I also got. I mean, trying to link the presentation, but I think that another consequences of the war on drugs is actually what you said about the peyote hunt.
Uh-huh.
They get arrested now.
Yeah.
That's because all of these drugs that, for several years were actually excluded
yes.
from being illegal
yes.
at some point. Since the drugs, since the war on drugs, they were included.
Right. Right. And when I was in San Luis Potosí in 2009, the peyote hunt was still ongoing. And I came across an article today in which it's becoming clear that Peña Nieto is going to include and has apparently made it clear that he will include peyote as part, but Calderón never did. So I don't know.
Yes, because it was also used for recreational purposes, peyote.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, you can buy it on the streets in, in Puerto Vallarta if you wanted. Now, for the huichols, though, they could go in, and they had a dispensation from the government because they don't sell it. But, you know, if you take someone with you that maybe should be on the hunt with you and they go and sell it on the streets, well, then I think this is where some of the problems are coming from.
Sure. It's very interesting how do you approach all the colonization process, if I may call it like that, or all the evangelical process by the Catholic Church when the Spaniards actually conquered those territories. And of course, it was not only the huicholes who stand a fight against all these processes, no? I mean, the rest of the Amerindios, as we call, well, all the Native Americans of those regions, actually, they wouldn't give up their beliefs, So it was a furious and dramatic process of colonization and evangelization, if I may say so,
Oh, yeah, there's a great book on how difficult the conquest of Western Mexico actually was. And I mean, there was a 60-year, very, very violent war. I mean, conquering Western Mexico was actually much more complicated for the Spanish than, say, conquering the central part of the country. Conquering the Mayas was very difficult, too. But conquering these sort of dispersed Western villages was exceptionally difficult because they are dispersed and they're more independent, and they're not empires. And in many ways, it's still been very difficult for Mexico to grapple with these native peoples.
Thank you very much, Michelle. I would really like to take a deeper look at your research sometimes. Yeah. No? Thank you very much. Victor,
can I just ask Arthur to pitch in his two cents? I assume you would agree with what I just heard from the two of them, that enforcing the drug wars against indigenous peoples using traditional ritual drugs like peyote is something that you would probably consider unwise as well, because it's not going against the cartels. It's just creating a new market for trouble.
Yeah, that sounds good to me. I mean, to be honest with you, when I was a prosecutor, I mean, if it wasn't, a ton of marijuana, we didn't touch it. If it wasn't, in the hundreds of kilos of cocaine, we didn't touch it. Meth, we treated differently. As far as, I've never done a peyote case in my entire life.
Yeah.
I've never even seen it. And I've seen almost all drugs. So I don't have an opinion. I do think that, we tried for years to, make everything illegal, and it didn't work. I do not understand why our leaders in government in both countries just don't understand that this is not working. I mean, it just doesn't work.
Yeah.
You cannot try to, just magically say something is illegal and then expect it, especially when apparently it feels so good. It just doesn't work that way. I said apparently, Dean. Apparently. it just doesn't work. And the war on drugs is, it's a mythology. It's never worked. It never will work, and I feel very comfortable in my work as a prosecutor because we never cared about the drugs. We cared about the violence and the people, and that is who we targeted, and that worked a lot better than, trying to, do the buy busts, and I did a lot of those too. So that's my opinion on it, is why are you expanding something that doesn't work?
Fernando, I interrupted you.
Yes, well, very, very quickly, yes, because I know that we have a time limit. So, Victor, I have one question. I think this is very, very interesting, because probably I have I've had a different experience than you when it comes to that, but what has been your experience? with American and Mexican students when it comes to excellence, high standards, and education as a whole. Because, well, you actually comment something about measures of success, attitudes, for instance, things like that.
Well, I think that on both countries, in fact, there is a lot of similarities. Mm-hmm. I perhaps emphasize some of the contrasts, but I think that there is a lot that is in common. Mm-hmm. I believe that in both Mexican engineers and U.S. engineers understand the concepts of ethical professional behavior and standards of excellence. I believe the contrast is perhaps the expectations.
Okay.
Expectations, mm-hmm. what people expect as a project, as a life project. Mm-hmm. And it has a lot to do with the way the cultures and the societies are operating in both countries. We have let me give you one example, just very quickly. And I can speak more for the academia because that's the world that I live more into. Faculty members in the U.S., we always have a 9-month contract. Summers are additional and optional. Now, for most faculty members, summer means extra work or vacation, but unpaid. Mm-hmm. So people have to plan accordingly. Now, in Mexico, on the other hand, employees are 13-month employees. You know, they get aguinaldo. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So they don't have to worry. They don't have to worry about the summer.
It's about incentives as well.
Right. Mm-hmm. So, okay. So imagine how we would operate in the U.S. if everybody says, look, your year's salary is going to be divided into 13 payments. We'll give you the 13th payment in December. So then, but the summer, you're free. I think that would change drastically the way people operate. But that's kind of a way the system makes people operate.
Okay. Yeah.
But I think in terms of respect for success, respect for work, I think that the values are shared.
Are shared.
Another minor difference I'd like to point out, and I noticed this in young engineers in industry in Mexico. Mm-hmm. I think that status and title are really important in Mexico, mm-hmm. more than salary, more than money. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think in the U.S., title and status is no match for money.
No.
And consequently, I see, for example, I go to an industry and I want to talk to the manager or the general manager of the plant, and he happens to be a very young engineer with not much experience. But he's in charge of making decisions or doing things. And when I look a little bit further, it turns out that he or she is not really making that much money. Mm. But the title makes him really dynamic, really enthusiastic.
Sure.
So I think that there's some game behind it. Mm-hmm. In the U.S., management is left for the experience, for the people that have more experience. And also, in fact, it happened to me. When I graduated from Wisconsin, I went back to Mexico and worked for the National University of Mexico. After 2 years of being professor at UNAM, they made me chairman, mm-hmm. of the department. Uh-huh. That would not happen here ever. I mean, that's crazy. Why did they make me chairman? You know, I thought later on. And of course, my friends, I still remember them, and I still talk to them and remind them about it. But obviously, the administrative work was not much appreciated by my colleagues. They took the newest kid in the block. You are the chairman, you do this. I felt wonderful. I thought, oh, my goodness, that's wonderful. But uh-huh. when you come to think about it,
It's about status, position.
So status and titles are really important.
Yes.
But here is
the same thing actually happened to me, but I really don't care why today. Appointed me director. No. I really don't care. Well, thank you. Thank you very much. And finally, well, Arthur.
Yes, sir.
Well, that was, what did you get?
I don't know.
Okay. Well, yes.
Get a dog to sniff at.
What's that? No. Just one question. I mean, I don't want to make it more controversial as it is. Well, I think that you have all the facts, all the information. I mean, you dedicated a great time. You want to actually study this, to work on this, you know, and you actually know the facts more than anyone, at least in this room. I would have to say that. Nevertheless, I will have to disagree in one point. I don't really think, and I'm going to explain myself very, very quickly, that the Mexican government is actually doing a good job in what concerns the war on drugs. Perhaps from the perspective of the military, of police forces, of security policy. Oh, yeah, maybe you can say that. Nevertheless, if we look to another consequences, for instance, social consequences, that has been dramatic, has been extremely costly to our country, I am really not sure that it has been a great strategy in order to end up with this problem or to at least try to stop it. Let me tell you something. I do remember the Mexican society during the 80s or the 90s. The average Mexican, if you remember my colleagues and the people that are from Mexico, we always knew that there was a problem with the drug cartels. We knew that they were there. But actually, society never faced or never encountered violence about it. There was a political pact. You're absolutely right about it. No, actually, what happened back then, and this is, extensively researched about, and all the information, I mean, it's public and things like that. What the Mexican government did is to say the drug cartels, the most important drug cartels, well, you know what? You have your business. I am not going to mess with you. But don't mess with the citizens. That's it. Don't set a foot on the main important cities. And that is something actually really important. I am not saying that the best strategy in order to deal with, I'm talking about violence, know how to end all the drug trafficking problem, because I agree with you, legalization, I think, could be, one of the best strategies, at least one of the possible best strategies that we have right now. And I'm not saying that the Mexican government should actually make another pact with the most violent and important drug cartels, because I am not trying to be politically correct or morally correct in this respect. I mean, that doesn't it's good for nothing at this point in what is going on in our country, actually. No? But because I am really not sure that that is going to be the best strategy anymore. No? My concern, and this is what I want to ask you to tell you, and of course the rest of the audience, is that I have not seen yet a clear new strategy from the new Mexican government about this problem.
Sure.
And that is really, I am really worried about it.
Yeah. I mean, I think there is, not to be semantical, but it's not, I don't think I said that the government has done a good job. I think I said the government has had some successes. and they have had some successes. And I would I'll counter with 2 points. One, either Mexico is a country that is rule of law matters, mm-hmm. or isn't. And I don't think you can have an in-between. Either the rule of law matters or it doesn't matter. And this is a, it's not an American concept, but Americans take this very, very central, that the rule of law, this is a nation of law, not a nation of man. And I think that is my first point, that either the rule of law matters or it doesn't matter. Either you allow the cartels to flourish nonviolently, or you combat the cartels. I don't know how you can do both. The second counter-argument I would make is reality bites. And maybe they should not have poked the line. Maybe they should not have started the war with the cartels. Because maybe there was, this peace, up until 2000, and then it exploded in 2006 when they started killing off the leadership and the power vacuum started. But that's reality.
Yes.
They did. And I think that I don't think you can put the line back in the cage at this point. I think it's out. And especially when you have the formation of the Zetas, which, if you guys mm-hmm. have experienced on a level that nobody in this country understands, we do not understand at any level. Unless you've been to a combat zone, you do not understand the amount of violence that goes on in certain regions of Mexico. We're talking about 100,000 people are dead. That is a big, huge number. That's huge. And I think that a lot of the people that have opinions about, what we should do in Mexico, a lot of them are in ivory towers, and they're not affected by it. I'm not affected by it. Nobody in this room is affected by it, really.
Yeah.
I don't know what your personal life is like, but...
In Guanajuato, we are not affected by it.
Yeah.
We know about the war on drugs on the papers.
Yeah.
The same as you do, actually.
But
that's the point. Because we have a summer abroad program here, I want to point
it's
out
very,
on the
very
map.
Safe.
I want to point out on the map that
yes, do that.
This little
safe.
State in the middle shows no drug activity at all.
Yeah,
heavily controlled by the government of Mexico.
I really agree with your points. And sometimes, a realist needs to take a step back and be like, well, what's actually best for Mexico? I still come down to the side of, the rule of law has to matter. And Mexico
Absolutely.
Is a country where the rule of law matters.
I agree
matters.
With that.
So, it's not something that I think we can solve.
No. You're absolutely right. Yes, the problem is that the Mexican government mm-hmm. opened Pandora's boxes.
Yep.
The Pandora's box.
So what do you do now?
How to close it?
Yeah, you stop
okay.
the supply and you kill.
That's the thing.
Okay.
Thank you.
It's.
Thank you very much.
I know this. I know the students and the rest of the audience have not had a chance to ask questions. However, there is a reception outside, at which our six panelists will be hanging around. I hope, and if you have questions for any of them, that would be a good time. To ask them, allowing them to chew their food, though. So thank you all, and enjoy the reception.